music education in the United States, public music education in the United States, didn't begin until the early 1800s. This instruction was really limited to the reading of notation and proper singing technique. Now, as curricular music education spread and eventually became the norm in American classrooms, the age range at which these opportunities were offered grew as well. Concurrently, the number of touring musical groups and performance venues in the United States was increasing. Singing schools had brought forth an interest in social music, and it took root and it spread rapidly. European artists were touring American towns, and more Americans were becoming proficient performers, were receiving musical training and becoming proficient. So there were instrumental groups in the United States made up of American performers, and these were bands and orchestras, singing groups, opera groups, and the like, that were comprised of United States citizens, and these began to take root, and they were sprouting and prospering in different areas. Now, these groups, with the invention of easier means of transportation, began to travel throughout the mid-1800s. They offered performances to cities and towns who often lacked local ensembles to offer that type of entertainment. And so the popularity and the demand for those kinds of groups began to surge. Now, bands in particular were of interest. These served the social needs of various social or community populations more so than orchestras did, primarily because the music that they played was outside of the standard, more formal European tradition. The music was more common, it was more accessible to the general public. It did not necessarily carry with it the same implication that going to a symphony and listening to a more formal body of work would. It was available to all classes of people, not just the upper classes who could afford a ticket to go. There were, in these bands, renowned bandmasters who emerged. Patrick Gilmore is one example. John Philip Sousa was another. And their bands began to perform works with a distinctly American flavor. And the response to this was overwhelmingly positive because, again, here was a music that resonated with the ordinary American people. And it was definitely something that the orchestral literature, up to a point, seemed to lack. Now, as Americans saw how well these bands fit their social and community needs, the demand for these groups swelled, and it swelled dramatically up until the turn of the century and into the mid-1900s. In addition to the popularity of these professional wind bands, it created a need for more of these ensembles, and music instrument manufacturers knew their industry was dependent upon the number of instruments needed. And that comes from instruments being purchased by community groups, by professional groups, and by school music programs. So school orchestras had, at that point, preceded the school band movement. And though the industry's rally for more music programs in schools helped to bring about the initial implementation of wind instrument education, it took a little while for that to take root and get started. The first wind instrument education program came into play in Rochester, New York in approximately 1917 and followed in Oakland, California. So we had it going on the East Coast of the United States and on the West Coast of the United States as well. Now, a mere 2 years later, a gentleman by the name of Lewis Aiken organized the first true high school band, and that was in Cincinnati, Ohio at Hughes High School. These programs received quick support, and many felt strongly at the time that the values that were taught in these programs, or that were learned by the students, even if they weren't directly taught necessarily, resonated very well with the progressive ideals of citizenship and democracy, which at the time were key goals in the United States. In addition, and this is notated in Michael Mark's book, Concise History of American Music Education, he notes that many felt that the personal benefits of socialization and healthy recreation, as well as character development, that what a student received in those regards from participation in the school band were crucial, just as many of us would argue on the behalf of students in our modern music programs. We often, in modern times, and as a band director I do it too, justify our programs in the means of the extra things that it teaches our students. And it's interesting to think that even back then, the early 1900s, school band directors were doing the exact same thing. Now, as inventions came about throughout the Industrial Revolution in the early 1900s, we saw the invention of the automobile. People were not as dependent on means of entertainment coming into their towns, and they didn't have to wait for them anymore. The automobile enabled people to travel. It enabled people to go seek out entertainment in whatever form. And so consequently, even though bands were a huge deal in amusement parks and town squares and parades and other venues, in both formal and informal performance settings, the invention of the automobile enabled people to go seek out other forms of entertainment. And so music instrument and manufacturers saw a decline, a huge decline, in the number of instruments they were selling to professional military organizations. Consequently, they needed to find a way to boost their sales. And so, they began to back the school band movement. And one of the ways in which they chose to do this was through the creation of national band competitions. So, these instrument manufacturers would sponsor these national band competitions, and bands would come from all over to different state and county fairs to compete. And there were prizes awarded, more than just bragging rights. Sometimes it would be a simple trophy or plaque, and other times it would be something significantly nicer, such as new instruments for their program. So they were lucrative incentives. There were lucrative incentives in place, and consequently, bands were drawn to compete. Now, some time went by, and the MSNC, which at the time was the Music Supervisors National Conference, we now know it as MENC, decided that companies choosing to sponsor these events exploited the school children who were involved in music education programs. And so they opted to regulate themselves these competitions, stating that they would be both organized and run by current educators, so that way there wasn't some kind of implication of impropriety on the part of either the schools receiving kickbacks from the companies for bringing their students, or so that the companies wouldn't look as if they were attempting to exploit students for their own personal gain, even though they were. The other great part about MSNC deciding to regulate these competitions was that they chose to put into place a catalog, if you will, of approved works for these bands to perform. And so what that did then was create a quality list of literature, boosted the standard of different performing bands that they had to achieve at a certain level in order to compete in these competitions. And so the standard of repertoire we saw the average school band able to perform dramatically increased. And we started seeing that there was a big push for improved educational materials. Now, we'll get back to that point in just a moment, but in the early years of these national band competitions, there were a few individuals who were able to grow band programs strong enough to merit unprecedented levels of community support and financing through their program success. The most prime example of these is perhaps one of the most famous bandmasters of all time, William D. Ravelli, who in 1925 was teaching music in the community of Hobart, Indiana, and chose to initiate a school instrumental band program. At the time he chose to begin his program and to get it started, he had no budget, he had no classroom to use, and in addition, he had no scheduling for his class during the normal school day, something that we in Texas often take for granted. We see our kids regularly, if not every day, then it's every other day or the like. Ravelli didn't have such luxuries. And so his band practiced several mornings a week before school. And on the mornings that they didn't, I'm sorry, on the days they weren't able to practice before school began, they practiced in the afternoons, but an hour a day. And after only 3 months, his band was able to offer their first concert to the public, which I think is incredible. A few short years later, 3 years later, I believe, their success was so noteworthy. They were playing such advanced literature as Rossini's Barber of Seville or even Washington Gray's March, which are both substantially difficult pieces in our repertoire. His town noticed the success of his band students and what it brought to the community in terms of entertainment value took hold of this basketball town in Indiana. And realizing that the director that they had running their band program was someone so special, the townspeople would have done just about anything that Ravelli would have asked them to do. In the midst of the Great Depression, Ravelli's band was still able to find funding to compete in the national band competitions and even to purchase new uniforms for the event. People in the town would sometimes be known to use less money on food during the Depression to be able to give to the band. Such was his success and obviously probably a personality to go with it. Something we hardly ever hear of happening, or actually never in my career have heard of happening. So well supported was Ravelli's band by the community that even the Hobart Athletic Club began to donate half their proceeds from their basketball games to Ravelli's band for funding purposes. Now, going back then, we start having these really successful bands in the United States, and there began to be a demand for not just academic teachers to lead these classes, which were quickly becoming more than just an after-school club. There were actually jobs available for people who were specifically band-oriented. And so along with that, the music industry began to grow because music publishers were now needed to supply appropriate repertoire for all levels of the band program. And along with that, we saw a need for there to be composers to write those pieces or transcribe pieces from the orchestral repertoire or to transcribe pieces from the popular music of the time. Band teachers also needed, as well as orchestra teachers, required method books to use in teaching their classes, which were heterogeneous at the time. A band leader would often find that they were not only teaching band, they were also teaching orchestra, they were teaching choir, they were teaching a general music appreciation course, if you would. So music publishers sprinted to keep up with the demand. One of the first books that came out on the market, you see a picture of here, and that was The Universal Teacher, which, if you could read the cover there, it was published in 1923 by two gentlemen. It was written by Joseph Matty and Thaddeus Giddings. Now, other methods followed, of course, as the industry for music education materials blossomed with new programs that were developing at the time across the United States. But surely there, at this point, was going to be no going back, and we would start seeing more and more programs develop, and we would see that funding for these programs became an expectation. So as the MSNC grew, and eventually became known as MENC, one of the decisions that was made, because the school band movement became so large and so prevalent in our nation's history, And we had students flocking into band programs like never before. And one of the decisions made was to no longer hold these national band festivals. I believe the practice stopped in the middle of World War II and never fully resumed. However, states then began to hold their own band festivals, and state organizations were developed, committees were developed to create the means for hosting these festivals. Other things that attributed to the development of the wind band in our public schools in the United States, certainly we can't talk about the history without mentioning the contributions of Frederick Fennell, who in a way was a little bit of a visionary in creating the wind ensemble at the Eastman School of Music in 1952. Now, that very first concert was intended to be a simple concert of music for winds. It was performed by just college students, music majors at the university, and the success of it was so remarkable and the response so positive that it was immediately brought into being a regular event, and that the ensemble became a permanent fixture on the campus. And as other universities caught on to this, so did school bands. People wanted to play the literature they were hearing, and they wanted the bragging rights, if you will, of being able to say that their band was playing the same repertoire. And so school bands became more and more popular, more and more students flocked into membership. We started seeing the amount of repertoire steadily, almost exponentially increase, both for advanced repertoire and for regular repertoire as well. Today, the school music program is something that's arguably in danger of becoming obsolete, and there are a number of reasons for this, but the predominant one, truly, is finances. As schools find themselves under more and more pressure to produce academic results, other courses, electives in particular, the arts in particular, find themselves often the discussion of being put on the chopping block. And school bands are no stranger to that. Here in the state of Texas, we have what I think is really a privilege in that because our athletic programs are so strong, and our band programs tend to be strong as well, and feeding off our strong band programs are our choir and orchestra programs, and it just creates this cyclical upward push for all the programs to remain at a high level of performance, and consequently, the number of students we have drawn in to participate in those programs is so high that it's rare in our state that we hear about necessarily programs being on the chopping block. Perhaps financing, yes, but the entire program itself, no. We might see reductions in staffing, certainly in budget, and the ability to buy materials or fund trips or take the band football games out of town, but in essence, the state of music education as it stands in Texas is really quite good.